Good morning, good morning. Thank you so much for joining me. This is the lovely podcast, The Endurance of Labor Laws. I'm your lovely host, Leslie Sullivan, and today is episode 54, and we are going to take a look at the International Union of Electrical Workers. But first of all, I want to give a big shout out to my listeners, so here we go. A big shout out to Connecticut, Pennsylvania, Virginia, Texas, Oregon, New York, and Oklahoma. I want to do a little bit of housekeeping before we start this podcast. So in one of the previous episodes, we talked about the differences between fascism, socialism, and communism. And when I was getting ready this morning, for some reason, I was thinking about the presidents of the United States and some of our early presidents. And I got to thinking about, I was like, you know, I think we have forgotten who our presidents were way back in the day at the founding of our country, and also what all they went through and what all they fought for. Because they did not fight for socialism, communism, or fascism. They didn't want any of that. And thank goodness they did not want it, because you cannot found a free country on any of those. Because there is no real freedom in socialism, communism, or fascism. In fact, all three of those are a form of tyranny. So I'm just going to go through some facts here. Our first president of the United States was George Washington. He was born February 22, 1732. He died December 14, 1799. Technically, he served two terms as president of the United States, and he chose to retire. He did not want to be in political life anymore. He wanted to retire. And then he sadly passed away from a very severe throat infection. I believe it's a strand of the virus from influenza A or influenza B is what he passed away from. But it greatly inflamed his throat, and he passed away from that. So, but in regards to George Washington, he had a very amazing career. He had a military career. He also worked as a farmer. He owned land. He was a prospector as well. And then he got to serve as president of the United States. Like, he was appointed that and voted that because people saw something in him that was great. They thought that he would be a great leader for this new nation, this new country, because he wanted people to be free. And what people forget is that many of the original people that fought in the American Revolution against the British, most of them were British citizens. They were British civilians, I guess you could say. They were British subjects, and they went up against the monarchy because they were sick and tired of the tyranny that they were experiencing from the British monarchy. They did not want to be controlled and manipulated, and they were having to deal with unlawful legislation that was being pushed down their throats from the British monarchy, because the British monarchy is one of the monarchies that colonized America, the North American continent. We were not America, the United States at this time. But that's what people forget. America did not colonize anything, and we still have never colonized anything. It was these different monarchies looking for satellite locations to have wealth and industry that colonized things over here. But there were a lot of people here in the United States that were in this continent, I would say, because we were not the United States at this time. And they did not want to be overruled and overgoverned. Here's how dumb monarchies can be. They can push their citizens too far. They raise their taxes. They try to limit their movement. And for example, like there was an act that was passed on the colonists from Great Britain saying that you can't go past this mountain range or this river. Like you can't expand west. You're not allowed to go west and, you know, have more business or have more land. Like the monarchy, they didn't want their people to be happy, the British. They didn't want people that lived here in America to be happy. They just viewed the people that lived here as just subjects of the crown and sub-servants of the crown. Like they weren't even considered equal citizens to people that were still living in England. They pretty much viewed everybody that was over here in the United States as just the queen or king's personal piggy bank. They used them for money. Well, the colonists here had enough, and George Washington was one of them. See, what people forget is that our founding fathers and the citizens that fought against the British, They were actually very loyal people to the crown. They were actually very loyal to the British monarchy. But the British monarchy used and abused them for money, for land, and for enterprise. They didn't really value their opinion. That's why they overtaxed them. They didn't care that they were legally stealing from the colonists over here. That's how evil and greedy the monarchy was. So that's why our founding fathers, they formed a militia, they formed an army, and they fought against the British. They said, we're not doing this anymore. You don't understand our lifestyles. You don't understand our industry, our enterprises. You're just using us for money. But yet, when we send delegates and representatives over to the king's court and to the legislation, you don't listen to us. You've never been over here, but yet you act like you own us, you act like you know us, and you don't. That's why the American people got so mad at the British monarchy, and they went up against the British monarchy. And what people forget is that a lot of people died. A lot of Americans died in that war. So, you know, when it comes to freedom, whatever you fight for, there is also sacrifice. And our founding fathers, which George Washington is one of them, you know, it was not easy to go against everything that he knew. That's what people forget as well. They forget that he had to leave a completely different way of life in order to be truly free. And he knew that if they lost the war against the British, they would be publicly executed. And what people don't know or don't remember about monarchies back at that time, especially the British, is that when you went up against the crown and you lost, you were called a traitor, you were convicted of treason, and you were publicly executed, regardless of whether you're male or female. But if you were a male, it was really brutal, because one of the ways they executed you was being dragged and quartered. Now, what people don't know about that is what it means, because we've lost a lot of that history, and we don't execute people like that, because it's very inhumane and cruel. To be dragged and quartered means, for a man, that they hang you up, they hang you by a noose, but they keep you alive, they castrate you, possibly pour tar on you. They cut you down while you're still alive, breathing for air. They tie ropes around each one of your limbs, like arm, arm, leg, leg. They tie each one of those ropes up to a horse or an ox, and they pull your limbs off of your body. And they drag your body at the same time. That's how cruel and evil the British monarchy was. That's what they did to people to basically instill fear in other people so that way they won't ever go up against the king or queen again. Now, just think about that. Like, really let that sink in, because that's what our founding fathers were risking. They were literally risking being tortured and mutilated publicly and being murdered publicly, being publicly executed. So these men really put their life on the line. And there were women that put their life on the line as well. Even though they didn't serve as president, they served on the battlefield. Like, they helped, you know, cook for the men. They helped do all these things. And that's not to say that women are subservient and that's all that they are, that, you know, that's all they can do is cook. Not by any means. These women knew how to shoot. They knew how to do a lot of things. I mean, they knew how to pluck a chicken's feathers. They knew how to skin animals. They knew how to fight. They knew how to shoot. I mean, this was a way tougher life back then than what we have now. And they knew that they had a right to bear arms. Both men and women, they had a right to bear arms. So just because women wore skirts all the time back then, that doesn't mean that they didn't know anything, that they weren't educated, and that they didn't do any type of hard labor, and that they didn't fight in that war as well, because they did. Some of them were on the battlefield helping out. I mean, because they knew it was a fight for their life, because they knew that if they lost that war, all the men in their family were probably going to be killed. And then they would probably be put into indentured slavery, if not be hung on a tree, be publicly executed. So they knew it was important. And I mention this because all of these people, basically our ancestors of our country, our founding fathers and all the citizens that were here at that time, They literally put their lives on the line for this country and for the founding of this country. They were doing something new, something that had never been done before. They were fighting for true freedom, for true liberty, without the help of any monarchy, because they were fighting their monarchy. And also, these men that fought, especially these higher-up men, these men that had status within, you know, British society, they basically lost the gentry. They basically lost their title in terms of British society. They lost a lot. So it wasn't just, hey, we're not happy about something, let's go fight somebody. No, it was not that fickleness. It was serious, and they really meant it. So I think it's important to remember who fought for what and what it really means. Because, again, they did not fight for communism, fascism, or socialism, because they were already having to deal with a tyrannical monarchy that did not value their property, tried to steal their property. In fact, they did. They were overtaxed, and they knew that they were not being treated like equal citizens. They were being mistreated. All of those things happen and occur under fascism, socialism, and communism. You're not considered an individual. You're just used as a piece of property, and the government thinks it can have access to your property and to your wealth, to your money. It's the same thing. So that's why it was such a risk for our founding fathers to say, no, we're not doing this anymore. We're not doing this anymore. We're drawing a line in the sand, and we're going to stand up for what's right. How many people do you know that do that today? That draw a line in the sand and say, we're going to stand up for what's right. And I don't mean that today everybody should form a militia. I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying in terms of morals and values and actually standing up for what you believe in and not just throwing a hissy fit, like actually being human. Because to stand up for what's right is to be human. Because if you don't stand up for what's right, then technically you're being inhuman. And you're also being inhumane. Because you're not defending what belongs to you. You're just allowing people to steal from you, and you're also allowing people to steal from rich people because you think rich people don't deserve what they have. Well, that's exactly what the monarchy thought about all the wealthy landowners over here in the United States. They thought, oh, you don't deserve that. It belongs to the queen. Even though the king and queen never came over here and worked the fields, they never bought or sold anything over here. They didn't go out and prospect land or territory. They just sat on their throne and just wanted to tax people. They lived in extreme comfort and richness and then gave themselves permission to steal from other people. That's why our founding fathers went up against the monarchy of Britain, because they didn't want any part of that. They did not agree with legalized thievery. And that's what overtaxation, high taxation is. It's legalization of thievery, and they knew that. Because they knew that if you don't call out an oppressive power when they legalize thievery of high taxation, overtaxation, they're going to do other things, which is exactly what the monarchy did. They confiscated their property. They confiscated their guns if they could get their hands on it. And then they made it so that British officers were in charge of all the towns and cities over here. They militarized it. Instead of there being freedom, they took more and more freedoms away from the colonists over here. Like, really put that into perspective. What if our military busted in your door to your house, confiscated all your weapons, and then just lived in your town or city, and they could enter your house at any time without a warrant and do whatever they want to you and your property? That's what the British were doing. They were cruel to the colonists over here. They were evil. Not all monarchies are bad. In fact, some of them are very kind to their people, but during this time frame, they were not nice to the colonists over here, the British monarchy. And you know what? A lot of the men that lived over here who had wives and children, they didn't like their families being, you know, brutalized like that. Because these soldiers were horrible to their wives and to their children. I mean, how would you like it if a military officer barged through your door, broke it down, and then just assaulted your wife, like just punched her in the face, basically said, hey, you're below me, and I want all your guns, I want all your weapons, and don't even think about buying anything else. That's what they were doing to the citizens, or to the colonists over here. The monarchy legalized thievery, and then they legalized brutality over here in the colonies. So I always find it very interesting whenever Great Britain today, whenever they talk about inclusivism and they talk about how great a country they are, and then they totally just want to whitewash and totally forget about what they did to colonists over here in the United States way back in the day. Because you got to remember, not everybody that lived here was a slave. In fact, most people that lived here at that time were not slaves. They were colonists. They were subjects of the British monarchy. And some of them were citizens of the monarchy. Like they were not subservient. They were not indentured slaves, and they were not slaves. Because you have to remember, there were black slaves and there were white slaves. White people, there is a white slave trade as well. People that were white slaves, they were known as indentured servants, meaning you went into service for a certain amount of time, usually 7 years at a time, and you earned your slavery, or you earned your freedom, excuse me. You were enslaved for 7 years, and then you were freed at the end of your term or your contract. And also, what a lot of people don't remember or don't know was that another reason why we had so many people over here from Britain at that time was because there was a pretty large ratio of children that were kidnapped off the streets of London and then forced to come over here to work in the colonies. There was a child slave trade, a white child slave trade. So it's not just blacks that have been slaves. Probably I would imagine every race on this planet at one point in time either has been enslaved or their ancestors have had some form of slavery put upon them. Like, slavery is nothing new. The Israelites, also known as the Hebrews, they were enslaved to Pharaoh for 400 years. So, you know, just realize that that's not new. It's still not acceptable and it's still not okay. But in regards to the United States, there were a whole bunch of different type of people that lived here in the colonies. It wasn't just rich white people. There were some rich white people, but what you have to remember, probably 90 to 95% of the population that lived over here in the colonies, they were British. Their citizenship, their homeland was Britain. Because the United States was not around yet. We were just a colony. We were just a satellite location to Britain. And we left because Britain was mistreating us. They were being really cruel. And, you know, God bless our founding fathers. They said, oh, this isn't happening anymore. We're sick of this. You would appreciate us. You mistreat us. You mistreat our wives, our children. You bring slaves over here, whether they're white or black. We're not doing all this. This isn't right. And what people will get confused on is they'll say, well, Leslie, the black slave trade didn't go away for a long time. That's true. But not everybody here in the colonies was for the black slave trade. There were many people that owned slaves and freed them. A lot of times people inherited land, and with that land came slaves. So just because someone had slaves back then, that doesn't mean they actually bought them. They could have very well inherited them. And many of their slaves were freed by their landowners. And what also people forget is that after we left the British monarchy, and we were founded as a country, and we started growing as a country, as a nation, there were blacks that owned slaves. And there were also Native Americans that owned slaves. And we know this, especially in Oklahoma, because we have a lot of Native Americans that live here. And what they don't want people to know about their heritage and their history is that they owned slaves as well. They had slaves that were of other Indian tribes, and they also had black slaves. So whenever they cry, oh, woe is me, look at our pain and suffering, I have to go, well, what did you do to other people? Like, you can't cry wolf and then ignore what your own people did years ago. Like, I'm not saying that you should shame and blame people. I'm not for that at all. I'm saying if you're going to present the facts, you have to present all of it. Like, for example, George Washington, he had slaves. But he also inherited a lot of slaves. Like, whenever family members died back during this time, everything got passed down in that will. And slaves were considered property. That was just how it was back then. And that did not come from the United States, that mentality. The British monarchy instilled that over here. Because, again, the colonies were founded by Great Britain. So they started the slave trade over here in the United States, which we were not a country then yet. We were just colonies. That's just how it was. And another thing, George Washington, he inherited a lot of slaves whenever a relative would pass away, and he freed some of his slaves. Like, not all people back then were bad. Nobody's perfect by any means, and that's not to excuse anything, but you have to look at what was the society like at the time. What was the normal way of living? It was normal to own property. If you were rich and you owned property, it was normal to own slaves. That was just a normal part of life. But that part of life was instilled in their mind and instilled in their society by the monarchies that colonized there. That wasn't the American way, that was the British way. Because technically the slave trade was started by Spain, the Spanish monarchy. They technically started the slave trade of African Americans. And then other monarchies got in on it and started purchasing slaves and deporting them, exporting them, importing them, whatever word you want to use, because they were not treated as people because they were not viewed as citizens or subjects of that kingdom. See, that's a kingdomship. If you're not a citizen or a subject of that kingdom, you can be overtaken and you can be ruled. That's how monarchies operated back then. We still have some monarchies today, but they don't operate completely like that. Like, that's why the British people really don't like their monarchy. Like, their current monarchy and the royal family, it's just a name-only kind of thing. They don't really have any power. They like to think that they do. I mean, they're kind of popular, but I mean, they're not the be-all, end-all anymore. In fact, their citizens, they really can't stand that they still have any type of monarchy at all. They don't really respect them. Because people don't want to be ruled by the few. Who would? And so that's why our founding fathers fought against the British, because they wanted everybody to have freedom, and they knew it had to start somewhere. Like, they knew they couldn't fight and win a war to free slaves at this time because they themselves were not free. They themselves were subjects of the British crown. And they knew that if they wanted true freedom, they had to free themselves first. So that way they could be free to free their slaves and encourage other people to have citizenship within the country. Like, you have to do that in phases. That's just how it is. Because what good would it do? What good would it have done if our founding fathers and all the people that lived in the colonies at that time, if they had fought Great Britain saying, hey, we want to free all of our slaves, so we're going to fight against you. But yet, they themselves were not free. That's just dumb. Like, you have to free yourself first before you can free other people. So those are the decisions that they made, and they knew the only way that they could have true freedom was to separate themselves and get away from tyranny. Get away from anything bad. That's what they chose to do. And I'm going to get a drink of water. I'll be right back. Okay, we are back. So let's go ahead and get started on this union here. I just wanted to go through some history, a little bit of the United States and what we fought for. And because it kind of brings to mind how off track some of these unions get, because a lot of them are founded in fascism and socialism, well, not socialism, fascism and communism, kind of the top two that are really bad, because they're not the American way. And the way that you know if something's not the American way, go back in history and read on our founding fathers and realize what they fought for and what they risked their lives for. So, oh, also, I want to mention this. Just so you know, this podcast, whatever is said on here, is copyrighted. So if you use any of this material in a book or in anywhere, you have to cite it correctly because this is copyrighted, just FYI. So let's go ahead and get started on this union here. This is the International Union of Electrical Workers. It says the International Union of Electrical Workers, IUE, was a North American labor union representing workers in the electrical manufacturing industry. While consistently using an acronym, IUE, it took on several full names during its history. Originally, the International Union of Electrical, Radio, and Machine Workers, and after 1987, the International Union of Electronic, Electrical, Technical, Salaried, Machine, and Furniture Workers. The IUE grew out of a dispute in the United Electrical, Radio, and Machine Workers of America, UE. The UE had been founded in 1936 and was given the first Congress of Industrial Organizations charter in 1938. As in many of the new CIO unions organized in the 1930s, the membership and leaders of UE include a variety of radicals, including socialists and communists, as well as New Deal liberals and Catholics. Now, something I want to mention here about that. There are a lot of Catholics that are very liberal and are Democrat. There are a lot of people that think that, oh, if someone's Catholic, they must be conservative. No. I was Catholic for a good while of my life, and I was shocked at how many people in the Catholic Church are Democrat, and even worse, they're crazy liberal. I'm just like, how can you call yourself a Catholic, take the Eucharist, you know, partake of communion, but yet you believe in abortion even almost right up till the baby is born? Like, that's murder. Like, we have to call a spade here. Like, if someone can be born premature and they can be kept alive in a NICU, but yet an abortionist can abort a baby that's almost full term and it would stay alive outside the womb. So just imagine what that abortionist, that MD, that doctor, just imagine what that medical professional has to do to that little baby in order for it to die. In order for the abortion to be complete, they have to kill it. There are Catholics that are for that. And here's why that's weird. First of all, that's very immoral, unethical, and it should be illegal, a lot of that stuff. But also, it's a form of eugenics. And for those that are not aware of eugenics, eugenics is where someone else that is not you decides who lives and who dies. An example of this is the Aryan race. Basically, what Adolf Hitler tried to push onto people, even though he wasn't even Aryan. The Aryan race is supposed to be blonde hair and blue-eyed. He wasn't even blonde hair and blue-eyed. Like, that's how foolish people were to follow him. He's trying to promote the quote-unquote Aryan race where there are no flaws whatsoever, but yet he wasn't even Aryan. Like, that's just dumb. So you're going to have an Aryan race, but your leader obviously is not even Aryan. Like, it's so dumb. But here's the thing. There is so much cruelty and unethicalness and just inhumaneness in eugenics. Because they think that if your baby is retarded, it should be killed. They think that special needs people should be terminated. And that's what the Nazi Party did. That's what their fascist party did. What you have to remember is that before the Nazis became Nazis, they were fascist. That's why fascism is very dangerous to any country. Are they free to think that way? Sure, but they should not be in any way, shape, or form in any type of leadership role. The risk is too great because they target people and they usually end up killing them. And that's what happened in the 1930s. You had the fascists take over a lot of government control, a lot of government power, and then they became the Nazi Party. And one of the things they did, that the Nazi Party did, they encouraged people to practice eugenics. Because they viewed it as it's a form of birth control, basically. But they thought they should be in control of who lives and dies. And so one thing that the Nazi Party did was they made it seem like they really cared about people's kids. They made it seem like they really cared about the mentally ill, the disabled, the mentally retarded, you know, people that are autistic, you know, things like that. So what they did was they sent out flyers and they let people know that, hey, we want to take care of your loved ones. So they rounded up all these people's loved ones and said, hey, we know they're a burden to you, so why don't you let us take care of them? Well, what they did was they institutionalized all these people, these people's relatives. Basically, these families that didn't want to be burdened with their relatives anymore, they basically shipped them out. And so what the Nazis did was they experimented on these people, these innocent people, on how to kill them. They tortured them because they didn't see them as human. They viewed them as less than, how do I word this? If you were not Aryan, if you're not quote-unquote of the Aryan race, it didn't matter if you were Jewish or not at this point. If you're not of the Aryan race, they thought you were subhuman, and they thought you were the problem. They thought that you were the one with all the diseases, and that if we just get rid of everyone that's not of the Aryan race, then we won't have all these genetic defects anymore. We won't have the mentally retarded. We won't have the deformed. We won't have the autistic. We won't have the mentally slow. They got rid of lots of people. And mind you, some of the relatives of these people that died, some of them didn't care. They were relieved to get rid of them because they, quote unquote, didn't want to be burdened with other people and their problems, quote unquote, their problems. But the Nazis, they really, how do I word this? They didn't start out as Nazis. That's my point. It grew into that. They started out as fascists. They promoted their agenda of the Aryan race. They started perfecting how to kill people and more people at the same time because they didn't want to waste money. They actually did not want to waste bullets on people because bullets, they're made out of metal. So they knew it could get very expensive shooting all these people. So that's why they start gassing people. But get this, the original ways that they were gassing people, they failed at it. So there were some people that were still alive as they were screaming. So they perfected a way of how to kill people and in large quantities and then get rid of them. And they thought, you know, we can't bury all these people. It sure does take a long time to bury them, so that's why they put them in ovens. See, that's the grotesqueness of that. And what's interesting is that some of that grotesqueness is in the Catholic Church, even today. They're liberal Democrats. They're not normal Democrats. Like, I don't mind normal Democrats because they actually care about people. But some of these liberal Democrats, like, they're crazy. I've met some of them. I'm like, it is so creepy because it reminds me of eugenics. Because, you know, it's a very selfish way of living. It's like, well, you know, I'm not retarded, so why should I be responsible for anything? I'm not deformed. Why should I have to deal with your problem? You're the burden. You know, you're the genetic defect. I'm not. Well, you know, if we just got rid of you, we wouldn't have any more of these genetic defects. That's not how genetics works completely. Sometimes, you know, you can have a male and a female come together, have sex, she gets pregnant with a baby, and they can be two perfect specimens. They can both be blonde hair, blue-eyed, Aryan, perfect Aryan couple, right? Something can still go wrong in the womb, whether by accident or maybe there was something genetic that they didn't know was there. But unfortunately, if you think like some of these crazy Catholics, they don't think you have the right to be born and they don't think you have the right to live. They think that if you are diseased in any way, you are the problem and you should be gotten rid of. And they think this way in the Catholic Church. There are so many people that are Catholic that are pro-choice and extreme pro-choice. It's not just, oh, well, you have an abortion the first few weeks. No, some of them are all for killing babies. They're all for it. And they use all these excuses. Well, you know, we're overpopulating the planet. We don't need another carbon footprint. Doesn't matter how small the footprint is. We can't have another carbon footprint. We got to think about the ozone layer. Us, you know, people are really polluting the planet. Do we really want these, you know, these babies being born? They're the problem. That's the arrogance of that. It is sick. It is grotesque. So it doesn't surprise me at all, being what I know and what I've seen and heard and experienced of being around these crazy people in the Catholic Church, I'm not surprised at all that Catholics would side with liberals even back then in regards to this union. Catholics have been liberal way before that word was used commonly today. See, they're secretly liberal. And here's how they're secretly liberal. They hide behind the cloak of the Catholic Church and then give themselves permission to do whatever they want. They don't care who it hurts or who it degrades. Because when it comes down to it, they think their life is more important than somebody else's. So being that they think their life is more important than somebody else's, they don't care if your life gets snuffed out or gotten rid of. Because they're still alive. They think this planet belongs to them and only them. And so they will shame and blame anyone that they think does not deserve to live, or that does not deserve to be successful, or that does not deserve to have a nice house. That's what they do in the Catholic Church. They shame and blame until you can't take it anymore, and you either leave, or you just give up on life. But yet they claim to be religious. They claim to be Christian. Or they claim to be the original Christians. I'm sorry, the Catholic Church was not around when Jesus was on this earth. Jesus did not found the Catholic Church. Jesus founded Christianity. But the Catholic Church has tried to steal it and tried to say, we are the original Christians. Guess what? No, you're not. Because you know what? The apostles, they went out all over the place. So there's different types of Christianity that were founded all throughout the planet, all throughout the earth. That's why we have Russian Orthodox. That's why we have the Eastern Church, the Western Church. That's why we have all these different rites within the Catholic Church. That's R-I-T-E-S. There's 23 different rites within the Catholic Church. And it's typically based on where the apostles founded their Christian churches. And it deals with the language of the land of where they founded their churches. You know, the Vatican in Rome is not HQ for Christianity. Heaven is HQ for Christianity. Our Heavenly Father is number one. Not people, and especially not the Pope, and not some bishop or priest or nun or layperson. It's our Heavenly Father. But unfortunately, when it comes to Catholics like this, they think they're number one. And they give themselves permission to do whatever they want. Well, that's very similar to a lot of these unions. And it's very evil and wicked because they don't care who they trample on and who they hurt. And they did a lot of harm in the 30s and 40s. Because that's when, you know, in the 1930s, now mind you, eugenics is nothing new. I think we talked about this in a previous podcast. Eugenics has been around since the beginning of time. You can see eugenics being utilized in the Old Testament with these different pagan religions when they would sacrifice their children. One of the number one reasons why they would sacrifice their children to these pagan gods was because they had too many children and they wanted to get rid of one or two of them. So that way they wouldn't, quote unquote, feel burdened. Does that remind you of what we just talked about with the Nazis claiming to want to help their families? They got rid of people because they thought they were a burden. It's the same thing way back in pagan times. Of course, we technically still have some pagans these days. They just don't want to call it that, but that's what it is. But we're talking about like biblical times here, like Old Testament. There's a reason why God wanted his people to turn away from pagan religions, because number one, those pagan religions were not the true God. And number two, they were giving themselves permission to murder and to murder babies and to murder children. See, they gave themselves permission to commit crimes. That's very similar to what these crazy liberal Catholics do. They give themselves permission to vote in a very unethical way, like be extremely pro-choice, not just a little pro-choice, but extremely pro-choice. And then put on their holier-than-thou clothes, their veils. And I'm not against veils, but you know, if someone is so pro-killing babies, I'm sorry, you really have no right to act religious whatsoever. Because technically what they're doing to these kids, these babies, in abortion is demonic. It's evil. It's wicked. Like, if it's not what my Heavenly Father would do, I wouldn't think it would be okay. If it's not what Jesus would do, then it's not okay. But you have people that like to give themselves permission to do whatever they want, whenever they want, however they want, and they don't care who they hurt or harm. And what I was saying was that eugenics is nothing new. It's been used as a form of birth control for years. It's been a way to control population. Like, China is not the first population to try and institutionalize a one-child law. I think it's now, I think they're allowed now to have two children over there. Other societies have done that since the beginning of time. And it's been evil doing that since the beginning of time. Because it's not the right thing to do to kill somebody. Murder is murder. You know, think about the words birth control. They're controlling whether or not someone gets birthed, whether or not they get born. Why look at it this way? You and I were born. Why shouldn't somebody else have the opportunity to be born? To be free, to live, to breathe the air, to celebrate a birthday? To do all the things that you and I do, like who's to say that we are better than somebody else in terms of this? That eugenics thinking was rampant in the 1930s. It was rampant. And also in the United States. It was not just in Europe. It was in the United States, and it was being horribly utilized in our prison system. They were sterilizing graphically and horrifically sterilizing prisoners when they were in prison during the 1930s. Because they thought if you commit a crime, there's something genetically wrong with you and you don't deserve to procreate. You don't deserve to have a normal body, so they mutilated it in prison and they didn't even give them a choice. They were brutal to them. That happened in the United States in our prisons. Especially here in Oklahoma. It was cruel. So, but think about that. You have people that are okay with bad things happening to what they claim to be bad people. Because they think they're good and nothing bad should ever happen to them. Like, we don't want bad stuff to happen to anybody. But what's weird about some of these fascists, communists, socialists, and you've got these crazy Catholics, they think their lives are more important than other people's. Well, when you have that thinking, again, it creates inequality. And that easily branches out into all different types of evil. It's not just about the workforce. It's not just about wages. Because if they think that way about the workforce and wages, what else do they think they're better than somebody at? That is an everyday life thinking. It's a choice to think that way. They are choosing to think they're better than other people, and they think that their life is more valuable than someone else's, especially a child's. That's where it gets really bad. That's why inequality is really bad. That's why degradation of any kind is super bad. Because it almost always goes after someone else's life. It may not immediately do so, but eventually it does do it. And it's really sad when that happens. But there are so many people, they just want to live their own life. And when they do that, you know, there's nothing wrong with being an individual and being individualistic, but it doesn't make sense, and it's not right to make it so extreme that no one else has value, when in fact they do. So just know that just because someone claims to be Catholic, that doesn't mean they're religious, and that doesn't mean they actually believe in God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And that doesn't mean they're living the way they're supposed to. Believe me, I've met some really cruel ones, and I'm like, whoa, whoa. If anybody should never be in a position of power or should never work in the medical field, it would be some of these crazy Catholics. It is really creepy. But anyway, it says here, concerned about the rise of fascism, these diverse forces put aside differences to form a popular front. The UAE's first president was James Carey, a follower of Catholic social teaching, and Secretary Treasurer Julius Imspach was allied with the Communist Party. In 1941, however, the communist faction moved to take total control and voted Carey out as president. Opposition emerged with socialist and New Deal elements forming UE Members for Democratic Action, modeled on the liberal anti-communist Americans for Democratic Action. The Catholic element worked with the Association of Catholic Trade Unionists. Between 1946 and 1949, the so-called right wing, as the anti-communist faction was referred to, led an effort to win back leadership of the UE. While the anti-communists built support with the expulsion of the UE from the CIO in 1949, a new tactic was used of forming a new union, the IUE, with Carey as its leader. With the support of the CIO, over 300,000 former UE members joined the IUE in its first 3 years. While academics debate whether to call it union raids, the IUE relied on NLRB elections to determine which union had the right to represent workers. By the mid-1950s, the IUE had easily overtaken the UE as the dominant union in electrical manufacturing. As the major union at the General Electric Company, IUE confronted, I think it's, Balwarism, I'm thinking. I'm just going to say Balwarism because I'm not sure how to pronounce this word. Lemuel Balwar was GE's vice president for labor relations from 1947 to 1960. Under Balwar, or Balwar, however you want to pronounce it, GE would present the company's contract offer to the union and no revisions would be made. The point was to make collective bargaining meaningless and lessen the value of the union in the eyes of its members. In 1964, the National Labor Relations Board declared such tactics to be unfair labor practices. So it says here, Balwarism, or Balwarism, however pronounced it, is the tactic of making a take-it-or-leave-it offer in a negotiation with no further concessions or discussions. It was named after General Electric's former vice president, Lemuel Balwar, who promoted the strategy. Goes on to say, the IUE was one of the leading forces in the civil rights movement. IUE President James Carey chaired the AFL-CIO Civil Rights Committee, and the IUE played a leading role in the 1963 March on Washington. In 1972, IUE filed a discrimination lawsuit against Westinghouse Electric, claiming that Westinghouse's wage structure resulted in less pay for women than men earned for comparable jobs. Women at Westinghouse earned only 80% of that of men doing similar work. IUE's victory in the suit helped establish the legal status or helped establish the legal basis for pay equity. Now, what I want to mention here is that that's not the only way that places of work can discriminate. Here in Oklahoma, we have a lot of employers, unfortunately, that they pay single people less than married people. So it's marital status discrimination because they think that if you're married, you deserve more pay because you're procreating, you're popping out kids, and because you're married. So they think that single people don't deserve or need that money, which in fact they do. They do deserve it because the job is not about procreation. It's not about spawning kids. It's not about getting married. The job is about the job. If someone has the skill set and the talent and they're being paid a certain wage, they should be paid that wage based on the job description, the performance, and what they're willing to do. It has nothing to do with what takes place outside of work. It has nothing to do with, you know, procreating, spawning your kids, getting married, getting divorced, daycare, all this stuff. A job is a job. However, I personally have experienced discrimination based on the fact that I'm single. And also, there are employers that they did not want to hire me because I was single. They think that married people are more stable than single people, which nothing could be further from the truth. Because most of the unstable people I've met over the years were married. And they had been in and out of relationships for years. Because divorce is so high. So it's like, really, like, don't pull the marriage card on me. Like, I'm all for marriage. I think that's great. I look forward to getting married. I look forward to having children. But it's not appropriate to use marriage as a status symbol and also to use your kids as a status symbol and as a way to discriminate against someone else that's not married and doesn't have kids. Like, often what I call Oklahoma is I call it the USS Noah's Ark, because it's like, if you're not married and popping out kids, well, especially for women, if you're not married and popping out kids by a certain age, you're considered weird and you're considered an old maid. And at some point, once they think you're too old, quote-unquote, to have children, and that you're not worth marrying, they don't even really care anymore that they think of you as an old maid. Like, it's just like you're nobody, which is really weird. I'm just like, wow, really? Grow up. Grow up. It is so strange. So that's not the only way that there can be discrimination in the workforce and in the workplace. Because I experienced that for years. And I'm just like, you know, you're not supposed to ask people in an interview if they're married. So what I did was I started wearing a wedding band on my left hand whenever I would go into these interviews. I would just give the impression that I'm married. And if they called me Mrs. Sullivan, I just let them think it. Because I wanted a job. That is sad. That I had to be quiet about my marital status because I risk losing the job opportunity. And another thing, I mentioned this in a previous podcast, that I was also overlooked for promotion and for, not commissions, but what is it, bonuses, because I don't have any children. They think, oh, you don't need that money. Why don't you give it to someone who actually has kids and has bills? I'm like, oh, really? So you think I don't pay anything to the electric company, to the gas company? You think I don't pay any rent? Like, come on. Would you like being discriminated against like that? No, nobody does. But there is this this sense of entitlement. I'm better than you because I'm married and I have children. Therefore, I must be wiser and I must be more educated. When in fact, guess what? You're not. Just because you're married doesn't mean you're wiser and more educated. It doesn't mean you're better. In fact, some of the dumbest and stupid people I've ever met are married and have a lot of kids. Like, they just don't understand how to live. It's just like a free-for-all when you walk into their house. It's weird. And then they think because they're married that they can just tell other people what to do all the time. It's like, okay, just because you're legally, you know, getting laid doesn't mean that you have the right to tell me what to do at all, and it doesn't give you the right to look down on my life and my lifestyle. Like, that's shaming and blaming. You'd be surprised how many married people think they're better than single people. I'm like, oh, so do you think that you were stupid and incompetent when you were single? Well, no, I don't think that about myself. Oh, really? Then why do you think that way about me? See, that's the arrogance. That's the pompousness. It's that entitlement thinking that people give themselves permission to push other people down. They find some little, I don't want to say niche, but they find one little thing that they think they're good at, and they use it against other people to discriminate. And that's what creates a lot of hostility in the workplace and in the workforce and also in interviews. So now whenever I meet people, I am very quiet about my private life. Like, I've always been private about it, but I am especially quiet about it now. Like, I don't tell people if I've met a really good guy or I'm dating a guy or thinking about getting engaged. Like, I could care less what people think, because guess what? A lot of these people are not invited to my wedding. Like, I know that when I was in my 20s, I thought, oh, I want to get married. I want to have a big wedding. Now that I'm older, I'm like, I am not doing that. I want to have a beautiful wedding, but guess what? There's not going to be very many people there, because there are not very many people that I think deserve to be at my wedding. And it's because of discrimination. I'm like, why would I want the Debbie Downers? Like, I don't have to prove anything to them. It's the same thing in the workplace. It's the same thing. Like, when you go in for a job interview, you don't have to prove your worthiness. Just be yourself. And if your employer doesn't value you as a human being, and they don't care that, hey, you're being yourself, then you shouldn't work for them. If they're going to discriminate you because you're a female and because you have ovaries, then don't work for them, because guess what? The moment you get married or the moment you get pregnant, they're going to think, oh, no, we got another one that's going to have a baby bump. Now we have to deal with her taking maternity leave, and, oh, she'll want paid maternity leave. These employers can be horrible to women, especially pregnant women. It is bad. Like, I don't know if you guys realize this, but did you know that even the ancient Egyptians had maternity leave, and it was mostly for the men? The men actually got to go home and be with their wives, with their newborn baby. That was ancient Egyptian society. And it's actually documented on papyrus and in their pyramids that some of their workers, their wife had a baby or something, and they went home for maternity leave and got to be with their wife and their newborn. So maternity leave is not new. It's actually thousands of years old. And both men and women used to get maternity leave. What a shocker. I mean, that's sad. An ancient empire did not even practice discrimination in the workplace like that. Now, against slaves, sure, they could care less because they weren't considered people. But in regards to how they treat each other, in the Egyptian society, if you were an Egyptian subject or an Egyptian citizen, you got maternity leave. But yet, it's not really considered valuable these days, especially for the woman. And another thing, whenever a woman goes on maternity leave, sometimes what employers will do is they'll hire someone in hopes that the person that they hire, you know, they claim they're just helping out so the woman returns to work, but they're hoping that that person will do the job better than the pregnant woman did, so that way they can legally or try to legally fire her so she can't come back, because they in fact don't want to pay for her maternity leave, they don't want to pay for her health care costs, and they certainly don't want to pay for her kid. They don't want to pay for the health care costs of her child. Because guess what? Children need vaccines. They need food, water, and shelter. And guess what? Oh, they need daycare if their mother's going to work. See, it's such a scam. I'm not saying all employers are like that, but this is nothing new, but we can do better as a society. We can do so much better. I mean, if you want to experience discrimination, come to Oklahoma. We have a lot of employers that they treat women like dogs. Worse than that, they treat us like cows, like all we're good for is breeding. And you'd be surprised how many women treat other women like that. It's really weird. So if anything, now that I'm 38, I don't get discriminated against as much because I'm considered old. And I just laugh at these people when I get in my car, because I'm like, wow, do you not know how many people are waiting until later in life to have children? Like, it's just like unbelievable. I mean, just because I didn't get knocked up at age 14 or 15, like some of the people I went to school with who went to these orgies out in the field, just because, you know, I wasn't part of the sexual activity in high school, like, that doesn't mean I'm used up and in a throwaway. But you'd be surprised how many people have said to me over the years, oh, you're not married? Well, you know, do you at least have a boyfriend or a kid? I'm just like, you gotta be kidding me. So basically what these people do, these shamer and blamers, these judgy people, they think that if you're not married by a certain age, well, at least you could get knocked up. You know, at least give your parents a grandbaby. You know, why don't you think about your parents? Oh, really? So I'm supposed to degrade myself, have sex with someone that's not my husband, get pregnant just so I can be socially accepted in society? You gotta be kidding me. But that's what some of these women do, especially these younger women. They're just wanting to be accepted. I'm like, why would you degrade yourself like that? Like, I don't know about where you guys live, but in Oklahoma, we have a very high rate of domestic violence here. We have extremely high rate of divorce. We have extremely high rate of sexually transmitted diseases amongst high schoolers. Like, that rate is really high. It's really sick and gross. We also have one of the highest teen pregnancy rates. What else was I going to say? What else do we have really good stats at? Besides, you know, some of the most tornadoes, and we have some of the most earthquakes, but they're not killer earthquakes like in California or something. But we have a lot of people that it's like, if you don't do what someone else wants, then you're not doing what you're supposed to be doing in your life. I'm like, really? Who set those expectations? Who made up those stupid rules? And what I don't understand about these people, they've said such weird, sexually sick things to me, and they don't even think they're being sick. They just think it's normal. What they don't realize is that they're taking good and pure things out of marriage and making it about something else. Like, sex is supposed to be confined to a marriage between one man and one woman. That's just how it is. If you don't agree with that, hey, that's your opinion. That's your life. I'm not in charge of your life. I'm only in charge of my life. I'm just saying what I believe and what I know to be true. Marriage is between one man and one woman. And marriage is supposed to be sacred. Like, it's a covenant between us and God when we get married. So what I don't understand about these so-called Christians that come up to me and start talking to me about this stuff, oh, you're not married? Well, do you at least have a kid? I was like, oh, so, you know, before I started aging into my 30s, it was, why aren't you married? Why aren't you having children? But now that I'm in my 30s, I'm like, oh, well, at least you could be having sex outside of wedlock and have a kid. So basically, I'm supposed to commit the very sin that was being shamed back in the day just to satisfy what you think about my life and what I should be doing. That's where religion totally gets it wrong, because God did not establish religion. He just established his church. It was mankind that created religion. In fact, God does not like religion. He doesn't believe in it because he didn't create it. If you want an example of that, look up the Sadducees and the Pharisees. He really could not stand them by the time Jesus came on this earth. That's why Jesus called them hypocrites. Because they believed in punishing people more than loving people. They utilized God's law to be cruel to other people. They didn't want to lift them up. They wanted to tear them down. How is that any different than what's going on in some of these workplaces? People are taking things that are meant for good and using it for bad. Labor is supposed to be a good thing for people to earn a living, to be successful, you know, to be happy, healthy, and whole, and do all those wonderful things. But then you get bad people into bad management, and guess what they do? They discriminate, and they hurt people. And they start deciding who's worth more than somebody else. Guess what? It's not a matter of who's worth more than somebody else. That has no bearing on this. It doesn't matter if someone's male, female, gay, straight, or sexually confused, or LGBTQ, whatever other alphabet number or whatever they put in there. I don't care. It doesn't matter what someone is sexually. A job is a job. It doesn't matter what someone's sex is. A job is a job. You don't pay someone less because of what they were born. You don't do that. At all. Ever, ever, ever. It just amazes me what people think they can get away with. And sometimes they do get away with it, and they especially get away with it in these Bible Belt states, because they use religion as a way to dictate employment. Like, I remember this one job I had years ago. I was working in an accounting office. And I mostly worked with women, which was absolute hell. It was like working in a hen house. Because women can be really cruel to each other. I'm just like, look, I'm just here to do the job. Like, if I make a friend, that's great. If not, I could care less. I just like working. I really do. Well, these women, man, they wanted you to know what religion they practiced, what they thought about marriage, you know, what they thought about their lifestyle, what they thought about your lifestyle. And it's just like, you know, I was just more nose to the grindstone. And they got angry at me for getting promoted and getting a raise. And I'm just thinking, okay, well, who's sitting here gossiping and who's actually doing the work? I was thinking that I didn't say it. But it's just, I'm here to do my job. That's all I want to do. And then when they realized that I was doing really good compared to them, they did whatever they could to sabotage my work. And guess what? Management did nothing about it. Because they didn't want to deal with it. They didn't want to deal with the unprofessional behavior of some of their employees. And the reason why was because they had unprofessional people in management. So they had the wrong leaders in place. And they were not acting in a leadership manner. It was just a free-for-all in this office. Like, I would often have to plug my ears just because of some of these sick sexual conversations that would be taking place amongst these women. And they weren't gay by any means, but sometimes women just are way too graphic and it's sick. Like, sometimes women are worse than men in offices and workplaces. And they get away with it because they're quote-unquote women. And it's like, you know what, I don't care you've hit menopause. I don't care that you've had a hysterectomy. I don't care that you're dry as a bone when it comes to having sex. I don't care. That's not my job. That's gross. That's sick. You have a problem. Go see an OBGYN. Oh, but that's right. You don't believe in modern medicine. So it's like, if you don't believe in modern medicine, then why are you talking about anything to do with your body? Like, I just roll my eyes. I'm just like, this is so weird. And most of these women were older women. I was one of the youngest women there. There was only two other girls that were younger than me. So you had three young girls and then all these old hags we worked with. And normally I love working with older people, but these women were just horrible. They were just unbelievably unprofessional. And I was like, wow, I can see why some of them have gotten married and divorced. And I can see why their husbands really are not interested in them anymore. Because if they talk like this at work, what are they talking like at home? I bet their families can't stand them. Because it does matter how people behave in the workplace. But more importantly, it matters who is your manager hiring. And also, who is upper management hiring to put in charge of all these employees? Like, we went through like two or three accounting office managers while I was there. And I think I was there maybe a year, year and a half. To go through two or three accounting managers is ridiculous. It was so mismanaged. It was so poorly run. I'm like, you can't get anybody else that's good. Like, let us interview some people. Like, let the people who are actually doing the work and doing it really good, let us interview some people. Like, we know what to look for. You want a good team? I'll help you find a good team. Because the team you have right now, it's not acting like a good team. It's horrible. So the harder I worked, the meaner these women were to me. I just thought, you know, if you only knew how much I support workers' rights, how much I think it's important that women get equal pay, like, it's just like, but because they were so hateful to me, we never got the chance to get to know each other. We never got to have common ground. Never. Never. I ended up leaving. And what's interesting is that this company, it was run by a Iranian man. He immigrated here years ago from Iran. He's an idiot. These Muslim men, they are so stupid when they run businesses. They really are. They just think you can put a bunch of women together in one room and everything's going to be fine. I'm like, wow, what a moron. What a moron. He just hired whatever he could hire, and he wasn't going for professionalism. He just thought, oh, you have ovaries? Get in there. Oh, you got a uterus? Get in there. That's what it was like. He wasn't hiring quality. He was hiring quantity, like a harem, is what it was like. And I was like, wow, what a sexist pig. I couldn't stand working with him. I was so glad that whenever he would not show up, which it was rare whenever he did show up, but usually when he did show up, he was pissed off about something, excuse my language, he was angry about something and wanted to yell at somebody. So I stayed away from him because I don't like being yelled at. And considering that I was fairly new, I was like, well, I'm not in charge of any of this. I just do my job and do it well. Like, I'm not a manager. Not by any means at that job. But he just did not understand labor laws. He did not understand employment. He did not understand wages. He did not understand human resources. He did not understand accounts payable, receivable. He did not understand taxes. He did not understand W-2s. He did not understand W-4s. He did not understand accounting. He did not understand audits. He was a moron. But yet he was loaded with money, probably from back, Never Eat Shredded Wheat, from back east. I had to think where Iran is. We're in the west, they're in the east. You know, sometimes these Muslim men, especially the older they are, the more of a sexist, hideous pig they are towards women. They just think we all get along. I'm like, no, that's not how women are. We're not made that way. We're not built that way. Even men don't get along with each other. But yet they think, oh, you're a woman, don't really have a brain. Yeah, get in there. Have fun. You'll get along. No, it never worked. This accounting department had so many problems. But I'm going to get a drink of water. I'll be right back. Okay. Moving on, it says women at Westinghouse earned only 80% of that of men doing similar work. I wonder if any of those bosses were Muslim or Iranian or Persian. Probably not at that time. IUE's victory in the suit helped establish the legal basis for pay equity. Obviously, the Iranians have not heard of this. So in 1987, the United Furniture Workers of America, another CIO union, merged with the IUE. On October 1st, 2000, the IUE merged with the Communications Workers of America, CWA, and now forms the Industrial Division of CWA. IUE CWA now represents over 45,000 manufacturing and industrial workers in a wide range of industries, including automotive, aerospace, furniture, and appliances. So, we learned quite a bit with this one. But this is one of those where it's like an umbrella under an umbrella, which is, I guess, good in a way if you want more power and you want more numbers, you want more members. The only thing I get concerned with is with anything to do with socialist or communist, and this has direct links to socialist and communist, especially in its founding. So that's why in one of the previous podcasts we discussed what it means when you're talking about fascist, communist, or socialist. Because again, I would say the lesser evil of the three is socialist. But eventually it can turn into fascism or communism. Now in terms of which one's more evil, fascist or communist, sometimes I think fascist and other times I think communist, because here's why. The Nazi Party started out as fascist. But here's the thing. We have communist China that we're dealing with right now, and they kill people all the time, and we don't hear about it because they control and kill off some of their press. So both of them, I think, are equally evil. It's just they do evil things at different times. And it's always against people. They use the excuse of, oh, we're going after the banks. We're going after these industries. Oh, we're going to get you your rights. No, actually, they're not. If they're willing to go after somebody that hasn't actually done anything wrong, hasn't actually done anything illegal, much less immoral, then what makes you think they're not going to come after you? Like, the same thing happened in the Soviet Union. I think I've mentioned this before. My mother and I went to go see a documentary years ago. It was called Forbidden Art. And there's this guy over in the Soviet Union. He made a point to collect all the artwork that was banned during the reign of the USSR, the Soviet Union. The Soviet Union even tried to control artists and painters. They only wanted people to paint plump, pleasant peasants all the time. Everything's happy in the USSR. Everything's pleasant. You have food, you have water, you have shelter. You know, you're working for the community. Nobody owns anything individually because individualism is wrong. Capitalism is bad. You know, we're going to take care of you. We're one big family. When it was just the opposite of what was happening. So what the artists were doing at that time, and during that time frame, that era, they were painting what was actually going on in their country. Well, the government found out that they were painting realistic images of people starving, people dying, people being murdered. They were painting portraits of their leaders that were very evil. And so the government at that time cracked down on these artists and said, you either paint what we tell you to paint, or you're going to go to jail and or be killed. You're going to be executed for being a traitor. Because we don't want people to know what's actually going on over here. So if these artists wanted to stay alive and feed their families, they painted whatever the government wanted, which was these almost like Aryan race looking pleasant peasants, blonde hair, blue eyes, which here's the thing, hardly any Russians look like that. Most Russians have brown hair and brown eyes. That's just the Slavicness of them. They have a very almost Slovakian heritage in a way, but you have the Soviet bloc over there. They're not known for being blonde. They're not known for having blue eyes or green eyes. It's mostly brown hair and brown eyes, which some of those people, they can be very beautiful, but it's very rare for them to have red hair, blonde hair, blue eyes, green eyes, hazel eyes, gray eyes. It's always, always brown, brown. Well, these artists, they would kind of semi-rebel. Others would greatly rebel. If they greatly rebelled and refused to paint what the government wanted, and I think the government even had them sign a paper saying, I will only paint and draw what you tell me to draw and paint. Otherwise, I will be arrested. So it's basically controlling the press is what the Soviet Union did. And so you had some artists that would sign that paper and they never painted anything illegal. They just painted or drew the pleasant peasant stuff. Everything's great. The government provides and they've got their sickles and their hammers in their hands, all that good stuff, right? Everything's great. Well, then you had some artists that, yes, they would sign that. And yes, they would draw and paint what the government wanted, but they would also secretly draw and paint what was really going on. But they had to hide that art in the walls of their houses and in their attics and in their basements. Because sometimes military, not officials, but I would say soldiers of the Red Army who were very evil, you gotta remember they were worse than the Nazis, they would invade people's homes and go looking for the forbidden art. And if they found that this artist was doing any of that, they would arrest him and or his family and his children, and sometimes they would kill them. I mean, it wouldn't surprise me if they put them up against the wall out in the city or town square and just fire shots at them and just kill them, just execute them right there. Because that instilled fear in the community and in the population that, hey, this is what we're willing to do to an artist. Just imagine what we'll do to you. Those are some of the things that happened. Then you had artists that really rebelled, and they went completely underground, and they started painting and drawing everything that was taking place in their country because they knew their country was a secret society, it was a closed society, and they were waiting for the day to be liberated to where they could tell their story, to tell people the truth about what was going on and what is going on over there at that time. So there was this guy, he got wind of this forbidden art, so he went out looking for it, and he found some of it. And some of it he restored. And unfortunately, because of the chemicals he used to restore the art, it gave him lung cancer, and he died from lung cancer. So I wish he had practiced safer methods when restoring this art because he was inhaling these fumes, but I don't know what all he had access to back then. And I don't know if he was aware of how harsh these chemicals are. But he basically gave his life for freedom and for freedom of speech and for journalism and for the freedom to be yourself, especially in art. Because I think people forget that when you have a socialist, fascist, or communist party in charge of your country, even the artsy people don't have freedom. Nobody has freedom. And this was during a time in the Soviet Union when the Communist Party took over the banking system. They took over everything, just like what the Nazis did. They took over banks, they confiscated people's property. They controlled people's labor, they controlled their movement, meaning if you wanted to go to the city for the weekend, you couldn't just leave town. You had to get permission from the military officer that was in charge of your village or town. You had to get permission to leave. You always had to have your papers on you. You know, like, for example, in that movie, I think it's called Casablanca, and there's this military officer that says, papers, papers, where's your papers? And people, like, frantically looking for their papers, because if you don't have your papers on you, you can't get in a country and you can't get out of a country. That's what military regimes do. They turn you into a piece of property, and if you don't have the right stamp on you, you got a whole lot of problems. Big time. So I encourage you, if you have never seen the documentary Forbidden Art, you need to watch that. It was very eye-opening. Like, I didn't know much about the Soviet Union at that time because the Soviet Union isn't really taught in public schools. At least it wasn't back when I was in school. We were not really taught about communism or fascism. It was just kind of lightly touched on. At least we were taught about democracy and freedom and, you know, capitalism. At least we were taught that. And at least we were taught about our founding fathers and taught about them in a positive light, in a truthful light. I don't know so much now about what's going on with that because I don't have children in school. But I didn't have a lot of world history knowledge in school. We just didn't discuss that. It was not very common. So whenever I saw this documentary, I was horrified and shocked at what these people went through just in their everyday life. And they're not even political officials. They're not public officials. They're not like a public figure. They're just normal, everyday people like you and me. And if you're not a normal, everyday person and you are in a political office or whatever the case may be, God bless you. I pray that you have a wonderful life and that, you know, you're doing everything that God is calling you to do. But in terms of my life, just a normal, everyday life, there was so much I did not know about across the pond, as they say. I did not have a lot of world history growing up. So needless to say, I was horrified at what these people endured, and some of them were murdered because of what they drew and what they painted, because they needed an outlet for their misery, their pain, their agony. And get this, their own government tried to steal their voice. And a lot of the time the government was successful because if they didn't like your voice, they killed you. So technically, a lot of these artists that were murdered, they were technically martyrs. They were martyrs for the fight for freedom in society. Like, I remember looking at the credits at the end of this documentary, and I was just kind of numb. Like, I couldn't even get up. I couldn't even feel my legs. I was just numb. And so finally, my mom and I get up, and we walk outside into beautiful daylight. It's a beautiful sunny day. And it's just like, wow, the things, I was going to say we take for granted, but, you know, I wouldn't say necessarily take for granted, but it's just like sometimes we're just ignorant. And we don't realize how good we have. And that doesn't mean you're taking it for granted, because that doesn't mean you're taking anything. It just means that, hey, you might not be aware of what happened all those years ago. And sometimes ignorance is not bliss. So I think a lot of young people these days, they don't understand what the real root of fascism and communism and socialism, what it actually is. Its root is destruction of freedom. It's basically a form of thievery. And it is technically a form of slavery, because when you do not have individual freedom, you're technically a slave of whoever is over you. Whoever is calling the shots is technically your master. So if you live in a country like the United States, you're not a slave because you call the shots in your life. You have freedom. You have a voice. But if you don't have freedom, you don't have a voice. And what these tyrannical governments do, where it's fascist, communist, or socialist, they try and silence you when you try and be an individual, when you try and be who God called you to be. And here's another thing. Under socialism, and especially fascism and communism, especially communism, they hate churches. They hate religion altogether. They don't want you to know the goodness of God. They don't want you to have hope of any kind. The way that they skirt around it in the beginning is they say, oh, we want to be inclusive. We accept everybody. Religion may reject you, but we will include you. That's not true. All they're trying to do under the disguise of inclusivism is they're trying to make the government your religion. They're trying to make the government your God, as opposed to making your Heavenly Father your God. That's why in communist China, it's illegal to practice any religion. All Christian churches over there in communist China are underground. And if ever they get found out, they will be murdered. They will be executed, and probably publicly. But we probably won't hear about it because they have a closed and secret society. And they have instilled fear into their people, so they won't even think about speaking up about stuff like this. They won't even try. Because they have lived in fear and tyranny so long, they don't even have a clue of how to fight for freedom. Because they've never been allowed to stand up for themselves whatsoever. And that is really sad. But that is the end of this podcast. A little serious, but, you know, we got to, as usual, we got to call a spade on that. You just got to say it like it is, even if it has a little bit of a sting to it, even though it's factual. You just have to move forward. Because I'll put it this way. I am grateful that my mother took me to that documentary. Like, we didn't know what it was going to be like. Like, there was a little blurb in the newspaper. Hey, there's this movie, this documentary. It's called Forbidden Art. Please come to the museum. I think it was the Oklahoma City Arts Museum. We're going to be showing this film. Come see it. And we were part of the summer program at that time, where they showed different movies on the weekend, and they picked like a theme for the summer, and they played movies or documentaries within that theme the entire summer. So we saw all these different types of films that summer, and Forbidden Art was one of them. And, you know, I started asking my mom questions about the Soviet Union, and because I didn't even know what the Soviet Union was. I didn't really understand it. Like, I didn't know about the Soviet Union, the USSR, the Red Army, things like that. Like, I was so ignorant and uneducated. And so I just started asking my mom all these questions, and she just started telling me all this stuff, and she recommended some good books, because she thought I had been taught a lot of this stuff, not necessarily about this documentary, but she thought I had good general knowledge from public school. I was like, we didn't learn any of this. She goes, what were they teaching you? I was like, obviously not enough. Not enough by any means. But my point is this. In regards to this kind of podcast, it's kind of serious. Do not get Debbie Downer on this. This is just knowledge. That's why I say knowledge is power. Don't let it sadden you or dampen or darken your day. That's not the point of knowledge. Knowledge empowers you. Because I know from personal experience, once I saw that documentary, I was very much aware about the dangers of communism and fascism since seeing that documentary. I wasn't easily fooled. I was like, I've seen what that can do to people's lives. And it was horrible. So even though it was a little shocking, it's like, okay, now I know the truth. And when you know the truth, you don't fear stuff like you used to, because you basically learn from it and you grow from it. So that's what I'm hoping with this podcast, is to help people learn about different things, because You know, I'm learning stuff too. I'm right there with you on a lot of this stuff. Because working in a union is not my natural industry. That's not my job. But as I'm learning this stuff, like, I've had to really, I had to learn and grow as well. I'm right there with you. Like, I almost quit this podcast, if you remember, way back in the beginning, because of what I found out about some of these unions. It was so shocking and so irritating and so frustrating. I was like, how can this be happening in our country? Like, I saw the warning signs of it. So I thought, well, am I a quitter? No, I'm not a quitter. Even though I don't like everything that I read, I was very disappointed. But I thought, you know, is it better to be quiet or is it better to be a light in the darkness? It's better to be a light in the darkness because that way other people can see. That's why I chose to continue this podcast. I thought it was more important to suck it up and do good. I guess is my point. So, but anyway, the next podcast episode is going to be the National Association of Broadcast Employees and Technicians. That one should be neat. If we have not already done that one, some of this sounds familiar because we're dealing with media production. But I will double check and make sure that we haven't already done this one, and it might be one of those things where it actually just sounds familiar because it's under another union's umbrella. So that's no problem there. Definitely we'll double check this and make sure we're not duplicating anything. But until next time, I pray that you're happy, healthy, and whole, and that you have a wonderful day and a wonderful week. Thank you so much. Bye-bye.
From the small